This is Jay Krishnamurti's second public talk in Saanen, 1967.
We will continue with what we were talking about the other day. We were saying how important it is to be completely be free from the psychological structure of society. That is to be completely out of society. To understand the problems of the social structure of which we are part, we need a great deal of energy, not only to understand them, but also to be free from them. We need considerable energy, vigor, vitality. I think that becomes very obvious the more one sees how complex society is, how complex the individual that lives in this society, the individual who is part of this society, the individual who has created this society, the individual whose psychological structure is essentially that of the society. Now, to really understand the problems which each one of us has in relation to society and to the problems of relationships in that society, for we have only one problem, really, that is the problem of relationship in this social psychological structure. To understand and to be free of these problems, we need a great deal of energy. Not only physical energy, not only intellectual energy, but an energy that is not dependent on any motive. On any psychological stimulation. On any drug. And so, to have this energy, one must first understand, it seems to me, how we dissipate energy. We shall go into it step by step. And please, as we said the other day, the speaker is only a mirror. He's voicing what I hope is the problem of each one of us. And therefore, you are not actually hearing a series of words or ideas, but actually listening to yourselves actually observing yourselves, not in terms of what the speaker or of another formulates, but rather observing the actual state of one's own confusion, one's own lack of energy, misery, this sense of utter hopelessness, and so on. As we are saying, we need a great deal of energy. Which is not dependent on any stimulation. If we are dependent on any stimulation, that very stimulation makes the mind dull, not acute, sensitive. The more you take the drug, LSD or other forms of drugs, you may temporarily find enough energy to see things very, very clearly. But one reverts to one's former state, and therefore you are dependent on that drug more and more and more. So all stimulations, whether of the church or of a drink or of a drug or of the speaker, any form of stimulation will inevitably bring about a dependence, and that dependence prevents you from seeing clearly for yourself and therefore having the vital energy. So any form of dependence on any stimulation is lessening of the quickness, vitality of the mind. And we all depend, unfortunately, on something. It may be on a relationship, or reading an intellectual book, or having formulated certain ideas and ideologies. Or seeking various forms of solitude, isolation, denial, resistances. These obviously distort and dissipate energy. So one has to become aware on what one is dependent. So one has to find out why one depends on anything at all, psychologically. I don't mean technologically or depending on the milkman. But psychologically, why do we depend? What is involved in dependence? Because we are investigating together this question of what dissipates, deteriorates, distorts energy. And that energy which we need so vitally to understand the many problems. So, What is it on which we depend? Whether it's a person, a book, a church, a priest, an ideology, or a drink or a drug, various forms which each one of us has, subtly or very obviously. Why do we depend? And what is the, why this urge to depend? Please, I hope we are taking the journey together. You are not waiting for me to tell you the causes of your dependence, but rather in inquiring together we will both discover, and therefore that discovery will be yours, and hence being yours it will give you vitality. Does the cause of a dependence free the mind from dependence? You understand my question? I discover for myself I depend on something, an audience, which will stimulate me, and therefore I need that audience. Please follow this. I derive from the audience, addressing a large group of people, a kind of energy, and therefore I depend on that audience, on the people, whether they agree or disagree. The more they disagree, the more vitality one has. Then there's a battle. But if the audience agrees, then it becomes a very empty, shallow thing. So I depend. Why? My question is, by discovering the cause of my dependence, will I be free of that dependence? Go into it slowly with me, please. That is, I discover that I need an audience, because it's a very stimulating thing to address people. Now, why? Why do I depend? Because in myself I am shallow. In myself I have nothing. In myself I have no source which is always full, rich, vital, which is moving, living. In myself I am enormously poor. So I depend. I have discovered that, the cause. Now, will the discovery of the cause free me, free the mind from being dependent? You're following this? I hope. Or the cause, the discovery of the cause is merely intellectual. It is not a discovery. It's merely a discovery of a formula. Right? It's an intellectual investigation, and the intellect has found the cause which makes the mind dependent. Now, the discovery of that cause through the intellect, through rationalization, through analysis, will that free the mind from being dependent? Obviously, it doesn't. Right? So the mere intellectual discovery of a cause does not free the mind from being dependent on something which will give it a stimulation. Nor a mere intellectual acceptance of an idea or an emotional acquiescence to an ideology. So what frees the mind from dependence is seeing the totality of this whole structure. The whole structure of stimulation, dependence, seeing that mere intellectual discovery of a cause of dependence does not free the mind from dependence, seeing the total structure seeing the whole structure and nature of stimulation and dependence, and how that dependence makes the mind stupid, dull, inactive, seeing the totality of it alone frees the mind. Right? Can we proceed from there? Anasto, madam, anasto. No. Do I see a part of the picture, a detail, or do I see the whole picture? This is very important to ask ourselves, because we see things in fragments. Right? Because we think in fragments, and all thinking is in fragments. So I must inquire into the nature of what it means to see totally. You understand? Can my mind, please follow this, which has always functioned in fragments, as a nationalist, as an individualist, as the collective, as the Catholic, as German, Russian, French, or as an individual caught in a technological society, functioning in a specialized activity, and so on and on and on, everything broken up in fragments. The good opposed to the evil, hate and love, anxiety and freedom, always thinking in duality, in comparison, in competition, in comparing. So such a mind functioning in fragments cannot see the whole. I mean, if I, as a Hindu, I'm not a Hindu, or an Indian, which I'm not, if I look at the world from my little window as the Hindu, believing in certain dogmas, rituals, traditions, brought up in a certain culture and so on and on and on, obviously I don't see the whole of man, of mankind. So, to see something totally, whether it is a tree or a cloud or my relationship or any activity that I do, to see the totality of something, the mind must be free from all fragmentation. And the very nature of fragmentation is the center from which I am looking. Are you following all this? The background, the culture, as the Catholic, as the Protestant, as the communist, as the socialist, as my family opposed. You follow? So as long as I am looking at life from a particular point of view or from a particular experience which I have cherished, which I have gathered, which I have stored up, which is my background, which is the me, I cannot see the totality. Then it's not a question of how am I to get rid of fragmentation. I hope you're following this. Our invariable question would be, how am I, who function in fragments, not to function in fragments? That's a wrong question. So, here I am dependent psychologically on so many things. And I have discovered intellectually, verbally, through analysis, I have discovered the cause of my dependence. The discovery is fragmentary, right? Because it is an intellectual, verbal, analytical process. And therefore it is always fragmentary. Which means whatever thought investigates must inevitably be fragmentary. So I can see the totality of something only when thought doesn't interfere. I see not verbally, not intellectually, but the fact, as I see the fact of this microphone. Without any like or dislike, there it is. So I see actually what is, that I am dependent. I do not want to get rid of that dependence or to be free of the cause of that dependence. I observe. And I observe without any center. without any structure or the nature of thinking. I don't know if you're following me. So, when I observe that way, when there is an observation of that kind, I see the whole picture. Not a fragment of that whole picture. So when the mind sees the whole picture, then it is free of it. Now, I have discovered two things. That there is a dissipation of energy when there is a fragmentation, right? Is this all becoming rather too complex? Tant pis. I have discovered by looking, by observing, by listening to this whole structure of dependence, I have discovered that any activity of fragmentation is any activity of fragmentation, as a Hindu, as a communist, as a Catholic, or as the analyzer analyzing, which is still fragmentation, any activity of a mind that works, functions in fragments, is essentially a dissipated mind. A mind that wastes energy. Right? I have discovered that. Therefore, that discovery gives me energy to face any fragments that may arise. And therefore, as I observe as fragments arise, there is the dissolving of them. I'm afraid I'm doing all the work. So I have found the very source of dissipation of energy. That any fragment, any fragmentation, any division. And division means conflict. You following? Any conflict is waste of energy, right? And I think there is no waste of energy if I imitate. If I accept authority. If I depend on the priest, on the ritual, on the dogma, on the party, on an ideology. Because there I accept and follow. But the following and the acceptance of an ideology, whether it's good or bad, whether it's holy or unholy, is a fragmentary activity. and therefore it causes conflict. And any conflict which will inevitably arise as long as there is a division between what is and what should be, any conflict is a dissipation of energy. All right. And can one see the truth of this? Not how to be free of conflict. If you put that question to yourself, how am I to be free from conflict? Then you are creating another problem. And hence, you are increasing conflict. Whereas if you see, as you would see the microphone clearly, directly. Then you would understand essentially the truth of a life in which there is no conflict at all. Look, sirs, put it differently. We're always comparing. What we are and what we should be. The should be is a projection of what we think ought to be. We are comparing ourselves with our neighbor, with the riches he has, which I haven't got. We are comparing ourselves with those who are more bright, more intellectual, more affectionate, more kind, more famous, more this and more that. The more plays an extraordinarily important part in our lives. That is, the measuring that takes place in each one of us to measure ourselves with something is one of the primary causes of conflict. Right? In which is involved competition, comparison with this and with that. And in that we are caught in this conflict. Now, why is there comparison at all? Please put this question to yourself. Why do you compare yourself with another? Of course, that's one of the tricks of propaganda, of commercial propaganda, which is to make you think you are not, you know, all the rest of it. And from the very young age it begins that you must be as clever as that man through examinations and so on. Why do we compare at all psychologically? Please find out. Because you see, if I don't compare, what am I? I shall be dull, empty, stupid. I'll be what I am. If I don't compare myself with another, I shall be what I am. And through comparison, I hope to evolve, grow, become more beautiful, more intelligent, more this and more that. Will you? The fact is what you are. And by comparing, you are fragmenting the fact, the what is, right? And therefore that becomes a waste of energy. Whereas to not to compare and see what actually you are, doesn't matter what it is. Then you have the tremendous energy to look. And when you can look without comparison, you are beyond all comparison. So which doesn't mean a mind that is stagnant with contentment. On the contrary, so we see in essence how the mind wastes energy. And that energy is necessary to understand the totality of life, not just one fragment. It's like a vast field in which there are many flowers. I do not know if you have not noticed, if you have been earlier here, before they cut the hay, there are 1,000 flowers of many colors. But most of us take one particular corner of that field and look at in that corner one flower. We don't look at the whole field. We give importance to one flower and giving importance to that one flower, you deny the rest of the flowers. And that's actually what we do when we give importance to our image of ourselves. Then you deny all other images. Therefore you are in conflict with every other image. So, as we said, energy is necessary. Energy that is without a motive, without a direction. And as most of us are rich with the things of society, there is no poverty in us at all. You understand? One must be poor inwardly, not rich with the things which society and we have built up. What society has built in us and what we have built in ourselves is greed, envy, anger, hate, jealousy, anxiety. And with that we are very rich. And To understand all that is to, one must have an extraordinary vitality, both physical as well as psychological. You know, poverty is one of the most strange things. The various religions throughout the world have preached poverty. Poverty, chastity, and so on. Poverty, the monk assumes a robe, changes his name, enters into a cell, picks up the Bible, reads that everlastingly, and he is poor. They do the same in different ways in the East, and that's considered poverty. Vow of poverty. You have one loincloth, one robe, 1 meal a day. And we all respect such poverty. But those people who have assumed the robe of poverty are rich with the things of society, inwardly, psychologically. But they still believe, they're still greedy, they're still seeking position, prestige, they belong to this category of religious type and that type, which is all the divisions of a culture, of a society. That's not poverty. Poverty is to be completely be free of society. Though you may have few clothes, have a few meals, good God, who cares? But unfortunately, in most people, there is this urge for exhibitionism. And poverty becomes a marvelous, beautiful thing when the mind is free from the structure, the psychological structure of society. And one must be poor inwardly. For then there is no conflict. There is no seeking. There is no asking, no desire, no nothing. It's only this inward poverty that can see the truth of a life in which there is no conflict at all. Such a life is a benediction. That benediction is not to be found in any church, in any temple.
Can we talk over together what we said this morning?
la pensée fragmentaire gaspille notre énergie. Or, nous avons besoin d'énergie pour réaliser ceci. Est-ce qu'il n'y a pas un paradoxe?
Is there not a paradox when you say that thought functions always in fragments? And to realize that thought functions in fragments needs energy. Is that not a vicious circle? That is the question. I need energy to look. But to look becomes fragmentary and therefore dissipates energy. Therefore, what is one to do? Right? Is the question clear? I hope it is, because I think it is clear for myself. I may be mistaken. Right. You see, sir, I need physical energy. I need intellectual energy. I need an emotional, a passionate energy to tackle anything, a sustained energy. But I know I am wasting that energy in fragmentation, right? All the time I'm doing it. Then I say, what am I to do? Here I am. I want to have this energy to tackle all the problems of life immediately. But I am wasting energy all the time by not eating the right food, by thinking about this and that, being a Hindu, being my prejudices, my ambitions, envy, greed, and all the rest of it. Right? Now, in that state, can you do anything? Please, listen to the question first very carefully. Don't deny or accept. I am in a state of contradiction. I dissipate energy and I need energy. That is, I am in a state of contradiction. And that very contradiction is another waste of energy. Right? So, I realize whatever I do is a waste of energy. No? No? You understand? Action in a state of contradiction is a waste of energy. A mind that is confused, whatever it does, at any level, will be confused. Right? There is no one moment of clarity. And living according to that clarity will dissipate confusion. If I do that, then again that breeds another conflict. Therefore, furthers more confusion. Right? So, I see any action born of confusion brings or leads to further confusion. Right? So, totally in action. Because I have understood any action of a confused mind only leads to further confusion. I see that very clearly. I see that as a most dangerous thing. As one sees a great danger, I see that as clearly as that. So what happens? I don't act in terms of confusion at all anymore. Not clear. So inaction is complete action. Look, sir, let's put the question differently. I see war in any form. War, killing another from an aeroplane at great height or with a gun at close quarters, or a battle between my wife and myself, or a battle in business, a conflict within myself. Is war. I may not actually kill a Vietnamese or an American. But as long as I have as my life is a battlefield, I'm contributing to war. I see that. I see it first, as most of us are trained to see first intellectually. Which is fragmentary. And therefore, if I do any action in that fragmentary state, will only contribute to further war, to further conflict. Right? So I must find a state in which there is no conflict at all. With my neighbor, with my wife, with the in business, no conflict at any level. I must find a state, a quality of mind that is not touched by conflict. First of all, I must find out if there is such a state. I would like to have it. It may be purely illusory. Imaginary, theoretical, and theoretical, ideological, or an imaginary state is idiotic. It has no value at all. But I have to find it. To find it, I must not accept that there is. So, is there such state? I can only find out if I understand the nature of conflict totally. You understand? Conflict, which is the duality, the good and the bad. Not that there is not the good, not that there is not the bad. The conflict between love and jealousy. So I must look at it all. Please follow this. I must look at it. That is to look at it without any judgment, without any comparison, just to look. So I learn. I'm beginning to learn how to look not what to do. I'm learning how to look at this vast, complex field of life, neither accepting nor rejecting, comparing, condemning, justifying, but to look as I would look at a tree. And I can only look at a tree when there is no observer. That is, when the fragmentary process of thought doesn't come into being. All right? So I look. I look at this vast battlefield of life, which I have taken for granted as the natural way of living. That I must fight my neighbor, I must fight my wife, I must fight my, you know, compare, judge, condemn, threaten, hate. I've accepted it. Though the churches throughout the world have tried to civilize man, they have utterly failed. They have been the cause of more wars. So I have to look at this life, which is me. Can I look at myself as I am without any comparison and judgment? When I can look at myself without any judgment, comparison, condemnation, I am already out of society. Right? Because society always thinks in those terms. The great and the little, the powerful, the beautiful, the intellectual, the clever, the all the rest of it. So with one act I've understood this whole process of fragmentation. And therefore, one does not belong to any church, any group, any religion, any nationality, to any party. In actual life, it doesn't work what you're talking about. So to react is perfectly natural, isn't it? If you put a pin into me, I will react. Unless I am paralyzed dead. So, reaction is natural. Isn't it? Huh? Then what happens? I react. To pleasure and to pain. Those are the only two things I have to react to. The pleasure, I want it to continue. The pain I want to discard. So what has taken place? I admit, we accept, reaction is inevitable, natural. But why should it always be broken up into pleasure and pain? I react. Right? Then what takes place? Thought comes in.
Before that, if you act violently.
That is, you put a pin into me, I act violently. Hit you back or shrink. Which is violence. The running away from you or hitting you. Right? Both are violence. You feel antagonistic later. Or a second later. When thought comes and says, I must do something. Observe it, sir, very closely, and you will see it for yourself. You put a pin into me. I react. Why should there be any antagonism?
Because you're interfering with
me. Life is interfering with each one of us all the time.
Sure, so we resist that.
Now, find out, sir, why do you resist? Go into it a little bit.
It's the nature of myself.
Right, which is to protect yourself physically, right? I must protect myself physically. Now, why do you carry that desire for protection to psychological states?
Because I don't want to be pushed around psychologically. I want to be free, but I want to be...
Ah! Are you?
I am, of course.
No, sir. You're not following. If you may, sir, if I may point out, it's not very clear. Physically, physiologically, there must be protection. Because otherwise, I couldn't right. Now, why does the mind go carry over this desire to protect psychologically? Why?
Mind, it shouldn't be like that.
No.
But it is.
Don't say should or should not. What the fact is, psychologically we want to protect ourselves.
Yes.
Defend ourselves. Resist. Why? Huh? Go into it, sir. You will see. Why do I want to protect myself psychologically?
Because my eye has certain characteristics. Therefore, you might say, then I have to get rid of the eye, but you can't do that.
Oh, I'm not talking getting rid or anything. Why do I want to protect myself psychologically? I want to protect myself psychologically only when I don't know myself. Right? That's all. The more I know myself, the less I want to protect. Because myself is nothing. It's a bundle of words and memories. And I'm protecting a thing which is not. Which is merely an idea, a concept, right? And I'm protecting that. I'm resisting. I'm defending. I'm quarreling with everybody to maintain that. The moment I know the whole structure of that thing, there is nothing to protect. I know it's not a question of agreeing with me, sir. Do it. If you like to continue with them, you will. So look. Resistance, defense, attack, all these are forms of maintaining a certain quality which we think is important, a certain state which we want to protect, right? That's a great part of it.
There's a question of relationship.
Sir, you all right, put it your own way. Relationship.
Right. Now you don't want to have a hard relationship. You don't have a hard relationship. So there you have to step
in. No, sir. You and I are related. First of all, we have to understand what relationship is, right? Before we protect relationship. What is our relationship? If I'm married, if I have a husband, wife, and children, what is my relationship with another? Not theoretical, actually. What is my relationship with my wife or husband? Have I any relationship at all?
Well, you certainly live together.
And of course I live with my wife.
Right. And sometimes your relationship is friendly, sometimes...
Follow it, sir. Follow it. Go into it. I live with my wife. All the sexual appetites when I was young have gone, more or less. I still have them occasionally. And what takes place? During the life period in which I have lived with my life, I have built up a form of resistance. A form of acceptance, dominance, all that. Or acquiescence. I don't want to be nagged. I don't want to be bullied. So all that goes on. So I have built an image about her in myself, right? And she has built an image about me. Now, these two images have a relationship. Not me and her. So, there is no relationship.
You still don't want to fight?
First, wait, sir. We are inquiring into relationship, not fight. So I see this taking place. All my life has gone on. The image building and defending that image. And I see as long as I have that image in me, not in her, there must be a battle between me and her, right? As long as I have an image about her, there must be a contradiction. Though I may have a relationship with her as a wife, there is a battle going on. And if I want to live without battle, I must first be free of all image. Now, is that possible? Never to create an instant image about her. Whatever she does, bullies me, quarrels with me, nags with me, nags me, or I'm whatever it is, never to build an image. Is that at all possible? Which means I must have a mind that is so sharp. A mind that's very alert. So that whatever she says never takes root. If you cannot do it, of course you'll have the image of relationship, which will be always been everlastingly in battle with each other. What, sir?
I don't want to quarrel with my office.
All right, don't quarrel with your office.
All right, that's what I mean. Then you have to...
But much more importantly, why aren't you aware? If you can answer that, then the rest of the questions will be answered. But you want the peripheral questions answered without answering the questioning the fundamental issue, which is to be aware, to watch yourself.
You want to ignore the peripheral, it'll get you in lots of trouble.
Huh? Saye, going to get into a lot of trouble then. I will meet day after tomorrow.
Comment vous mettre sur le monde extérieur? Comment vous mettre sur le monde de l'existence? Et même de l'essence? connexion, ça peut être magique.
Vous avez compris? Qu'est-ce qu'il dit?
Comment pouvons-nous être sûrs qu'il y a un monde extérieur? Comment pouvons-nous être sûrs qu'il y a une essence de ce monde extérieur, si peut-être Maya?
Ah! How do you know the question? The questioner says, how do we know that there is an outside world? How do we know that there is the essence of what the outside world is? Perhaps the outside world is a Maya, a Sanskrit word. Now, the word Maya in Sanskrit, I believe, means to measure. Ma in Sanskrit means to measure, right? As long as the mind has the capacity to measure, it will create illusion. Naturally. So they have said, as the mind has no other capacity except to measure, therefore what it measures is illusory. Huh? That's a philosophy that exists in India, which is that all the world is Maya, is an illusion. So put up with it. Forget it. Your disease, your hurts, your the world, the quarrels, it's just an illusion. But a really hungry man, to tell him the world is a Maya, illusion, means nothing at all to him. A person who has got cancer, pain, talk about illusion means absolutely nothing. What matters is not whether the world exists or doesn't exist, whether an illusion, the fact is there is the world. There is you and I in battle with each other. Vietnamese are being killed by this or by that. So those are facts. And to understand facts, we must be in contact with them, which means to look at them without any interference of thought as prejudice, dogma, belief, nationality. Well,